on a sleepless night. As the storm goes on out of control, deep in her heart, the thunder rolls. She's waiting by the window when he pulls into the drive. She rushes down to hold him, thankful he's alive. But all the wind and the rain, a strange new perfume blows, and the lightning flashes in her eyes, and he knows that she knows, and the thunder rolls, and the thunder rolls, the thunder rolls, and the lightning strikes. Another love grows cold on a sleepless night. As the storm goes on out of control, deep in her heart, the thunder rolls.
U.S. air quality is better than it has been in decades. The U.S. leads the world in cutting CO2 emissions since the year 2000, all while becoming the world's largest producer of petroleum. We need oil and gas to provide the energy and products we depend on every day. And if we care about the environment, we should produce that vital resource here, because we do a better job on environmental issues than any other nation. That's what keeps America strong and Kansas strong. Get the facts at kansasstrong.com.
Preschool hangs around a Zipco line, reeling a bluegill half my size. It's hard to be the way that feels for a little kid that was the biggest deal. Till I ran that punt back all the way in overtime, and we took stay, soaked in Gatorade and high fives. Coolest night of my life. Yeah, it was until it wasn't, and I got lucky. One just a little bigger than the last one. Lord knows I've stumbled on a few, busted my knuckles for one or two. I'm grateful for my moments in the sun, but I hope the greatest thing I ever did, I still ain't done. I remember that very first song I wrote, the first time I heard me on the radio. Standing on stage, those lighters lit, the best damn high I had ever lit. Yeah, it was until it wasn't, and I got lucky and got another one, just a little bigger than the last one. Lord knows I've stumbled on a few, busted my knuckles for one or two. I'm grateful for my moments in the sun, but I hope the greatest thing I ever did, I still
Well, good morning. We're going to give it a couple more minutes here for people to hop on. My name is Sandra Wick, and we'd like to welcome you to our fourth session of our cattle conversations here in Central and North Central Kansas. So I've got about 10:01, so we'll give people about another minute to hop on, and then we'll get started.
Greatest thing I ever did, I still ain't done. I still ain't done. 'Cause I still ain't
to work for her that summer. A teenage kid so far from home. She was a lonely widowed woman, hell-bent to make it on her own. We were 1,000 miles from nowhere. We filled as far as I could see, both needing something from each other, not knowing yet what that might be, till she came to me one.
Okay, we're going to go on and get started here. Again, I'd like to welcome you to our K-State Research and Extension Cattle Conversation Series. This is actually round two of our cattle conversations. It started 1st of April, and we finish up next week. If you happen to miss any of our sessions, we have these posted on each of our district or county websites. So simply go to that or contact your agents and you can find those recordings that you missed as well. This is a collaboration with, as I mentioned, several other districts to make this happen. And we truly, truly appreciate all the districts and extension agents that have worked together to put this program on for you. That includes Central Kansas, Cottonwood, Midway, Post Rock, and River Valley. So let me move to the next slide here. Alrighty, so here's a picture of our team members from the districts that I mentioned. We're gonna start with Justine Henderson. She is the livestock agent with the Central Kansas District, which is Ottawa and Saline counties. And we have Alicia Bohr, the ag agent from Cottonwood District, which is Barton County and Ellis County. We have Clint Laughlin, who is the livestock agent with the Midway District, which is Ellsworth and Russell counties. And we have Brett Melton, who is a livestock agent in the River Valley, which includes four counties, which is Cloud, Washington, Republic, and Clay. And then my name is Sandra Wick. Like I mentioned, I am the Post Rock Extension District, actually crop production agent, but we've been without a livestock agent for a couple years. So I am also covering the livestock portion of this. My counties include Osborne, Smith, Jewell, Lincoln, and Mitchell counties. So we cover a pretty wide area here. Alrighty, so it's important that we keep you involved and engaged. So we want you to be able to ask questions if anything arises during the presentation that we have. So actually all of you are probably real familiar with Zoom, since that's kind of been the way people are doing things here in the last couple of years with the pandemic. So if you're unfamiliar though, we'll just kind of review here. There is a chat box at the bottom of your screen. So simply type in any of your questions in that. Also, if you have any technical questions, if you can't hear, if you can't see the screen, there's server agents on and we can take care of that as well. If you can't get your chat box to work, you can simply email your questions to myself at swick@ksu.edu or any of the agents on the team. If you know any of your agents' email addresses, you're welcome to email that to Clint, Justine, or Alicia as well. Let's move it to the next slide here. Okay, we also wanted to keep you very active in the presentation. So we will be asking you poll questions. So it's very simple. So during the presentation, we will put up some poll questions for you. There's a picture there on the right on what the poll will look like. You simply click on your desired answer that will be on the screen, and then we can share that response from you guys as well. So very simple, but we wanted to keep you engaged with that as well. Okay, without any further ado, it is my honor to introduce our speaker that we have. She's it's very special to me because she's actually a coworker, and Jody and I probably started about the same. She started a little bit sooner than I did, but we are kind of one of the first females in the ag positions out here. So we were kind of the pioneers out here. So, but Jody is a livestock agent in the Metalog District, and that includes three counties. And she works very closely with the producers in Northeast Kansas, but she is also a co-owner and co-manager of a cow-calf operation in rural Jackson County. So she kind of wears two hats as well. And maybe it's not Jackson County, Jody. Are you in Jackson County or maybe some other counties as well?
Yeah, I'm in Jackson County.
Okay. But she provides the K-State Research and Extension science-based and provides information from K-State to producers about raising livestock and hopefully sustaining the family farm and protecting our natural resources at the same time. So I'm going to stop sharing so she can get her slide presentation up. You all should have been emailed this morning with her handout, so you can take notes right on that handout as well. So we'll get her to share. Alrighty. Can everybody see the slides and everything? I guess if you can't, then you'll let us know. I think you're good to go, Jody.
Okay, Sandra, thanks for having me and the rest of the agents. Gosh, if I'm a pioneer, that makes me really, really old, I guess. But I'm here to talk about blue-green algae and what it is and how it relates to us. For about 5 years, it's really been a problem in my corner of Kansas, getting phone calls from producers that think they have it or have had sick or dead animals. And it's really kind of a concern that we've had. I took part in a study that the vet diagnostic lab did, and they had us submit water samples. And boy, that was a learning experience because some of the stock ponds had very toxic levels all summer and it never really changed. And so that's really what kind of piqued my interest. And then some close friends of ours had cattle die, and trying to come up with answers for them, it really got me interested in this topic. So what is blue-green algae? It's a group of algae that are cyanobacteria, and that is a photosynthetic bacteria. It creates its own photosynthesis. There's a lot of species of the blue-green algae that produce toxins and can be poisonous to people and animals. The toxins are in that cyanobacteria, and it holds it until it dies. As it decomposes, then it releases those toxins. And these blooms can change the color of the water. They are buoyant, so they float around, and they can go to the downwind side of the pond. It's the most unnatural looking blue-green color that you've seen. It almost appears like in the top right-hand picture that someone has spilled some paint in your pond. And these usually will have smells associated with it, which attracts dogs, you know, to the smell. Okay, how do I advance here? Okay. So when the water temperatures increase and we get warm, sunny days with little wind and there's been some runoff from rain, there's always an increased chance of getting blue-green algae. The causes of it are not completely understood, but we think it has to do with high phosphorus, high nitrogen, and warming of the water temperatures. Many of our larger reservoirs have it every summer, and our farm ponds are usually suspected of this when they have been fertile, when the grass around has been fertilized. But we also saw last summer a pond in the middle of the Flint Hills that was a new pond that had rangeland that was not fertilized, and it was one of the most toxic ponds that the vet lab had seen. So there's a lot of confusion with pond owners about what a blue-green algae bloom looks like. They go out to their pond and they see some of this, and I get these calls, oh, I think I have it. And a lot of this is just natural occurring in ponds. The top picture is duckweed. And this is just a little floating plant. And I noticed yesterday that this is starting to form in our ponds already. It's actually very high in protein. So if the cattle ingest this, it's a little supplement, I guess. And then you've got your normal pond scum. And then there's the filamentous algae. And there's three forms of that. There's a cotton mat type. There's one that looks more like a lump of horsehair. And then there's the slimy and green stuff. And that's usually what comes in if you're casting a fishing pole out and you drag it back in towards shore, you'll get some of that stringy moss algae on there. And a lot of people confuse that with blue-green algae. So what is our concerns about the cyanobacteria? It can cause reactions even if it's not toxic. And with humans, it could be a runny nose, rashes, skin irritations, and sore throats. But then as that cyanobacteria dies, it releases the toxins. And then with humans, it's severe stomach issues, vomiting, diarrhea, can cause liver damage, and you can get some numbness in your hands and feet. With pets and livestock, it's a staggering kind of weakness. They have difficulty breathing, convulsions, vomiting, and death. And it causes a sudden death if they've ingested enough of the toxic bacteria in the water. One of the KSU vets told me it's like cobra venom. There's no cure. There's no treatment. It's just a sudden death. So these are some of the warnings from KDHE last year. Milford Lake is continually in the news. One of our office professionals has a family reunion there. They rent the cabins, and they finally quit going because more than not, they were not allowed in the water because of blue-green algae. But you can see that it is across the state. And then if you look at national headlines, you can see that it's a worldwide issue with elephants dying and whatnot. So a toxic bloom cannot be seen. You can see blue-green algae, but you have no way of knowing if it's toxic unless you've done a laboratory test. So our KSU Vet Diagnostic Lab will do this for $22. And you can contact your extension agent or your veterinarian to get the water tested. But one of the things that you can do to determine if it is a blue-green algae bloom is to do the KDHE jar test. And it's very simple to do this. You just take a mason jar and get a water sample just below the surface of the water, and you don't shake it. You put it in your refrigerator overnight, and then you observe what happens. If the green algae sinks, then it is not blue-green algae. But if it floats to the top, then you have blue-green algae. Now, it could be just blue-green algae, or it could be toxic, and then you would want to continue with a further diagnostic test. This whole procedure can be found on KDHE's website. They also have a stick test, but this one I think seems to be a little easier for producers to do. So after we've had several deaths and all those ponds came back with all those high ranks of toxicity, then I began asking some questions of who's doing anything about this. And so we called a meeting in October of 2019, and we had all the people from KDHE, Bureau of Water, the Vet Diagnostic Lab, veterinarians, our water quality specialists, Middle Ark Extension District. There was other agents involved too. But we sat down around a table and discussed what we knew about it, what we didn't know about it. We also had KU Biological Institute, and they have a really cool facility there in Lawrence. Hate to say that, but they have 100 different little ponds that they are growing blue-green algae in and trying to figure out what is causing this and you know, what we can do about it. So we sat down and discussed all the different things that literature says you can do to treat a pond. And one of the things that really shouted out to me was that throwing copper sulfate into a pond is not really a good cure. So we came up with some ideas on how we could mitigate these ponds. And so one of the things we had read was that barley straw put into a pond as it decomposes can help prevent blue-green algae blooms. And we found the barley straw at a sheep farm in Quinter, Kansas. They raise barley for a fodder system that they feed their lambs. And then they have several hoop barns. And so they put the straw up. So they were gracious enough to bring us two loads of barley straw for our project. So we located ponds that had previous algae blooms, and the vet lab was very good about telling us which ponds they knew had blue-green algae. So you don't just throw this in there because you can kill fish by changing the oxygen level, but the dosing rate is 7 small bales per acre of surface water. And we stake these down around the edge of the pond, keeping them about 20 feet apart and at least half submerged. One of the things that we had a good year last year, but one of the things happened was some flooding knocked some of them out. So we went and reinstalled about halfway through the season. So KDHE did the baseline water testing for us. They tested each month for a nutrient profile, and then all of the different toxins that might indicate a blue-green bloom, and then a total chlorophyll and all of the algae that might be present. The COVID thing really kind of messed us up because their labs were dedicated to the COVID testing. So they outsourced this testing, and they spent a lot of money on the testing, and we still don't have all of the results back. And we had thought we were going to get it at the end of January. So it's really put us back. So the bales were installed prior to the bloom. And this is one of the KSU vet diagnostic veterinarians installing bales. And we tried to do it in early May before anything had bloomed. Like I said, this isn't a prevention, but it will kind of cut down on the algae. So this is a shot of the bales. This was at Melvern Swim Pond. As they decompose, it releases polyphenols and other chemicals that kind of retard the blue-green algaes. So the factors that can, you know, determine whether this works is the dilution of the water, any of the algae species that are already present, and other factors like flooding, for instance. So the ponds range from a half acre to 3 acres, and the management of all these ponds differed. The ponds were used for recreation and or livestock water. Three sites last year had a control pond that was pretty close to compare to. And they were located in Jackson, Jefferson, Nemaha, Shawnee, and Greenwood County. They had 8 ponds in total. So this was a good complement. KDHE had also done this in some water, public water supplies, Shawnee County Lake and Melbourne Swim Pond. And this pond actually had blue-green algae so bad that it had killed some livestock, and they have fenced this pond off as a result. So this is just some pictures of our crew installing the bales. A really good crew to work with. So more shots of the ponds, and some of the ponds we put bales in did not get tested. We just had some demonstration ponds that we did.
Jody, do you want to put any of the pools up yet?
Oh, gosh, thanks for, yes, let's do number one.
Okay, great.
I had it on my notes, but I forgot.
All righty, guys, there we go. So if you guys want to answer that question, over the last 5 years, do you think your ponds have changed? We'll give them about a minute here when it comes in. And you guys should be able to see it as it's coming in. Can you see it, Jody?
I don't see any results.
No, but you see, yeah, it, see as, it as the boats are coming in?
No, I just see the poll question.
Okay. 5 of 9 voted. So we'll give them a couple more seconds. I think enough of them have put it. So here's the results. Share the results. Now, can you see it?
Yeah, 80% of you thought that your ponds have changed. And one of the criteria, I guess, is that the water temperature is getting warmer faster. And in fact, already March of 2020, some animals in Miami County died of blue-green algae poisoning. So it's happening sooner and sooner. It has even been reported that blue-green algae has been seen under ice. So it may not just be a summertime problem though that we're facing. So, okay, we'll go on. These are just some of the ponds. And last year seemed to be a really good year for ponds. They were really clean and, you know, good for the ponds and good for the producers, but not good for our study. We did have a couple blooms, but we are gonna repeat the project this summer. So, yeah. So what's next? At a recent harmful algae bloom conference, we heard of all the different kinds of controls, and if you look there under SSF, that's a slow sand filter. That gives moderately effective control of intracellular and extracellular cyanobacteria. So this next year, we're going to start another project. We're also repeating the pond mitigation project, and we're up to 20 ponds. We're gonna be testing 10 of them, and the other 10 will be control. We did receive a grant from KCARE for the slow sand filters, and I'm working with Will Boyer and Jeff Davidson, a couple retired people, Herschel George and Pat Murphy are also kind of on this crew. And we're we're trying to design these slow sand filters. We also applied for the KDA conservation on-farm field projects with our local soil conservation districts, but did not get funded. So slow sand filters, kind of interesting how things go on around the world, and I'm not aware, but these were developed and researched by Harvard University. And this is how they clean water in third world countries for human consumption. And the diagram on the left is pretty good, except for the inlet and outlet are confused. The water comes in on the top, goes through a thick layer of sand and gravel. It gets pumped back out then upwards. So we're going to be doing these slow sand filters. And one of the things that, I love this, Smutzdecke is a German word. It's for a dirt cover. And this is the cover that forms on the top of the sand. And this is full of amoebas, protozoas, all kinds of crustaceans and good bacteria. This is the layer that will take out all of the bad stuff from the drinking water or from the water to make it drinkable. So we're doing our slow sand filters in these food grade chemical totes with just a little bit of PVC plumbing in the bottom and using some solar pumps to pump the pond water into this or using the outlet tubes. We're gonna run the pond water through this into a stock tank and test the water to make sure we're removing any harmful algae blooms. It'll also remove nitrates and E. coli. So we think that this can be easily replicated by producers to use on their farms. So our second question, Sandra.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay, I'm gonna get that up. So I'm going to stop sharing those results. We'll get the poll, the second one. There we go.
Okay, so in your pastures, what is your preferred source of water? Ponds, streams, springs, or stock tank?
We'll give them a few more minutes because I think only one of 10 of them. Oh, here more of them come in. So give them a little bit more time here to see if any more things come in. Okay, I think that's about enough. Okay, show results. There you go, Jody.
Oh my, it's a split. Well, that's great. I mean, if you have a spring, that's wonderful, or a stream, that's great too. In Northeast Kansas, it seems like ponds are our preferred source. And so we have 12,400 ponds in my three counties. And so trying to keep that water good quality for livestock is very important. And also for humans and our pets too. So then, Sandra, I guess the third question.
Okay, let me get that. There we go.
Have you had any experience with blue-green algae blooms?
So we'll give them a couple more seconds. So I don't think any more are coming in. Okay. Oh, share results. There you go.
Wonderful. I hope you never have to. I hope you never have to.
Yeah.
One of the questions I had asked the vets was, okay, if we can't really do anything to prevent this, Is there something we can do to the animals? Is there a bolus we can give them, or can you magnesium in the mineral to fight, grass tetany? Is there anything we can do to the animals? And the answer was no. So I hope we have clean ponds in the future, and we can prevent this from happening. So I'll take any questions, Sandra, if there's any.
I think I'm going to turn over to Justine. I think she's kind of the ones kind of handling the questions today.
Yep. So if anybody has any questions, you can go ahead and put those in the chat right now at this moment. Jody, you actually just answered my question right at the end there. I was curious more about the effects it has on animals and kind of what do we do in that situation to where if we do have an animal that's affected by blue-green algae, what do we do? But you kind of answered that.
Steve Ensley with the Vet Diagnostic Lab, one of his comments last summer was there's very few things that will kill animals when they're out to pasture. And so blue-green algae is one of the first suspects, I guess. And, he's challenged to get the word out to all the local practitioner vets that if they find or they get called about dead animals in the pasture is to quickly, do an autopsy and get the contents of the rumen and get that checked. So, it's like everything, communication. Death by blue-green algae is not reportable. So it's just if the vet diagnostic lab has been consulted, they know of those numbers. But so it's kind of a hidden problem, I guess you would say. But if you know you have it in your pond, it's really worrisome for the producer because, you have this wonderful pond out there that you would like to water out of, and then the water is not good. So do they haul water? Do they fence the pond? So we're hoping these slow sand filters is something they can still use the pond, just filter out the bad stuff and still have that water there for the animals. So Will Boyer is working on some solar pumps to pump the pond water into the filters and then out into the stock tanks. So we're excited about that project.
Awesome. So we have another question coming into the chat, actually a couple. In the research project, is there any education being done with the landowners?
Well, yes and no. We've had several contacts with the landowners. One of our landowners, the pond owner that we did a project on, he had heard about barley straw helping. And so several years before, he had unrolled a large round bale of brome in his pond. And as it decomposed, he killed all of his fish. So there's definitely a dosing recommendation. And as I had a pond management meeting, someone stood up and said, hey, I was baling around my pond and one of my round bales rolled down into the pond. And he said, that was the cleanest water I'd ever had. If they're trying to raise any fish, it can be really, really bad for them. Some of the recommendations, putting copper sulfate in, that can actually, of course, you can get copper buildup in your pond, but it can also encourage other bad bacteria. There are things like shade balls that you put on the surface, so the blue-green algae doesn't get any light. But our winds in Kansas, those shade balls all end up on one shore or the other. So aeration, there's just a lot of different things being sold. If you research this on the internet, you'll see all these wonderful foo-foo concoctions you can buy for $250 a gallon that may last, a couple weeks. So it's really kind of a beast, figuring out what causes it and how to prevent it. So
Perfect.
So that's all I have, guys, if there are no other questions.
Yeah, I've got one more question, actually. So in terms of kind of, and I don't know if you went over this already, but location-wise, in terms of Eastern Kansas, Central Kansas, Western Kansas, is it more common in a certain area, or is it kind of spread throughout?
It is throughout the state. Now, I think in Central Western Kansas, ponds are not as prevalent, maybe, but it is throughout the state. And as you know, I know climate change is kind of controversial, but as things start warming up sooner and whatnot, it'll go even further. This is a horrible problem down in Florida, and they have blue-green alliances, and we tried to get some grant money from them, and we're not a targeted state. So, but I do see this as a oncoming problem. If you haven't seen it yet, you probably will be seeing it. One of the KDHE researchers told me last summer that if something's not done with Milford Lake, it will be closed to the public. They had a blue-green algae bloom the size of an acre in the middle of the lake floating around last summer. So, and you know, we just don't know enough. We know it's from phosphorus, extra nitrogen, but we just don't know what combination, we just don't know enough about it to really prevent it.
One more question. Sandra's asking and is curious how long it takes for the test to come back from KDA.
From the vet lab, you should get it within a few days. So, and if you don't, you know, we send those samples in, but as agents, I guess I would encourage you guys to look on the vet diagnostic lab page on how to submit samples. So thanks again for your interest. If you have any other further questions, get a hold of me.
Okay. All righty. Well, thanks, Jody. And I do have one slide that you can see up. Again, this was the fourth session. We do have one more session. Excuse me. Let me take a drink of water here. But we do like to have you complete the evaluation, and Justine put that in the chat, and I think she'll probably post it again there, because this is what helps us determine our future programming, educational programs. So we really would appreciate your input so we can act accordingly. Our next virtual cattle conversations, our last one, will be actually next Thursday, April 29th, and we're going to finish up with our watershed specialist that kind of Jody mentioned. I think she mentioned Will Boyer, and they're going to be talking about providing adequate water for grazing livestock. So they'll be talking about pond management and tank management and that type of thing. So please be sure to join us for that. Let your friends know that. And again, we'd like to thank Jody for sharing that information, sharing the projects that they're working on. Jody, if any of the producers out here maybe would have problems, could they contact us and maybe let you know and maybe get some ponds in the study out here? Or are you interested in any more ponds?
Well, we're kind of full up. Okay. KDHE can only go so far from Topeka at point.
Okay.
But these slow sand filters, we're putting these on trailers. So if someone gets a hot pond and they need to have some other way to get water to their cattle, give me a call. We've got a couple of them. We'll have them set up and they will hopefully have the biofilm ready to go. And so that is an option. And if they just want to build their own, we can give them the specs on how to do that. But yeah, we'll help anybody. So.
Okay. Wonderful. Okay. Again, I think that completes our program for today. And like I said, these, the recording and the handouts will be posted on our websites as well. So we will see you next Thursday. Thanks again.
guys.
Thanks, Jody. So if you need to get going, you can do that. So it looks like we had at the most maybe 9 people on. Is that what you had, Justine and Clint?
Yes.
Okay. Right. Now, we do post this recording at our websites and we get other views as well.
Sure.
So if you'd like this recording to post on yours, we'd be glad to share that with you too.
Oh, that'd be great.
Okay. And then you can post it on your webpage.
Very good.
Okay. Thanks again, Jody.
That was good.
Yeah. Okay, I'm going to stop sharing here. There we go. Put them in the waiting room. Okay, I think we're the only ones on now. I put them in the waiting room. Okay, let me tell Alicia when we're done because she was going to stop there. I think I can stop the recording, but we'll. No, I'm going to call her real quick and tell her to stop it because then she puts it to her cloud or whatever.
Hi, you've reached Liz. I can't make it to my phone.
I'll just text her because she's probably driving. So
I think too, if we end the meeting, it'll stop recording.
Yes. I'll just see. So. Okay.
And she can always clip it out, or I can clip it out later.
Okay.
You can like edit the whole video, so then you don't get us talking.
Okay, because I don't think I can say stop it.
I can't either.
I can't either. So I'll just text her and then she can stop it. If we leave, we can do it. So I thought it went very well. I thought she just said the basics. It wasn't too long. It was about the right amount of length.
I think if you got any more in depth and that kind of stuff, then you would have started losing people. But it was very like, this is kind of.
Yes.
You
know, yeah. She just said the basics. Yeah.
Yeah, no, and lengthwise, I think that was probably really good too compared to our last couple of weeks. Not that the last couple of weeks was bad, it's just they got a little longer winded.
I know, and hers was the right length.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah. Do we think how many did we average per meeting in the first? Like in the ones in February, were we?
I think it was what, between around 10-ish, 10 to 13. I'm pretty sure there was 15 total on today. So I'm pretty sure we reached at least 10 attendees. Because I looked down and said 15 and it would have only been us 4 and Jody.
Oh, that's right. So there was 10 then. Okay, great.
I had only caught 9, but... 10 would be great.
Yeah, 10 will be great too.
Because I'm pretty sure I looked down at one point and it was 15. Because there was one person that kept coming off and coming on, and I don't know if they were having issues or not, but.
Yeah. Yeah, and I didn't see that Tiffany on, so maybe her class didn't do it today or something.
Yeah, but did you guys get the email that I guess she went back and watched Harmony's presentation?
Oh, yeah. We did get that.
Yeah.
Okay. So I think it went great.
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, I liked it.
Okay.
It was interesting.
Success too. So.
Yep. And the next time, let's see, Justine, you're in charge.
Yep. I'm sending him, he told me to send him a reminder email a week before. So I'll send him an email and give him a call today and then have him send me some poll questions or a
okay. question. Okay. So I will get those slides done because I kind of had the slack because I didn't get my slides done till last night at like 10:30. Yeah. That's okay. I mean, it's just changing that one slide, basically. That's it. Well, on the last one for the next one. But so I might put on there, let us know, because this completes our, you know, spring cattle conference break. Please let us know. Something like that. So, okay. I think we're done.
Great job, guys.
Okay. All righty. Have a great rest of the day. It looks like... It's going to be colder today and windier.
No snow, though, so that's a positive.
I think there's a chance of rain. No snow, but I think the wheat's still alive. Yeah.
That's good. We need it to be.
All righty. Thanks, guys. See ya.
See ya.
Uh-huh. Bye.